Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. MashaAllah. I think Maulana has said so much already. Just as he's not or see himself fit to speak to the group of ulama, I think I'm of lesser value than what Maulana is. I've seen so many students here. I'm sitting with people. It is my senior Maulana, a senior ulama, you know, that's more deserving of sitting here. But nevertheless, Maulana has asked me, and this was pre-arranged. I didn't actually prepare anything because I feel sometimes the best discussions is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in the heart of the people. But one day, Harun al-Rashid, rahimullah ta'ala, he was sitting and he was asking the person next to him, a person by the name of Yahya bin Aktham. He says, Man Ambalul Maratib, that who's the most successful person according to you? Who do you deem, who do you see as that person who's actually made it in life? Which person has the best status or stature? So this person was sitting next to the Khalifa. Of course, you're not going to disgrace the Khalifa. People always want taqarrub, they want proximity to those people in the riyasa, those people of authority. So he says, I think that you are the best amongst the people because you're governing, you're ruling over us, there's justice and all of these things. This is Harun al-Rashid, rahimahullah ta'ala. فَالْتَفَتَ إِلَيْهِ فَقَالَ لَهُ. He turns around and says to him, لا. He says that أَنْبَلُوا الْمَرَاتِبَ الَّذِي يَجْلِسْ فِي الْحَلَقَ. The best person in this world is that person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken, placed him in a halaqa like this, and then يُعَلِّمُ النَّاسِ قَالَ اللَّهُ وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ لِأَنَّ إِسْمَهُ مُقْتَرَنٌ بِإِسْمِ اللَّهِ وَإِسْمِ الرَّسُولِ. He says, because that person's name is actually attached to the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the name of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. This was the advice of a governor of Harun al-Rashid. Maulana knows the sad state of our ulama today. As much as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised the fraternity, as much as the Nabi alayhi salam has praised this fraternity, that is there, and those are some of the things that we can share and we can understand. In fact, whenever we are cornered or whenever people speak against us, then we will use the words of the Nabi alayhi salam in our defense by yuskitun nas, making the people quiet, basically, you know, that this is the maqam and this is the makan of the ulama, which is nothing wrong. But similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used an equal amount in condemning the ulama as well. As for the praises of the ulama, one of the most puzzling pieces or sentences that I came across, where the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam actually praised the ulama. For years I couldn't understand why did he use this example, is the hadith of Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala, the lengthy hadith. Some of our brothers will know that this is some of the first hadith a person learns when he studies, because he becomes so much affected with these words that becomes his motivation throughout his study career. And that is the hadith, Man Salaka Tariqan, that entire hadith. There's no time to make sharaf of it, but one jumla, one sentence is where the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam actually said, Wa fadlul alim ala al abid, ka fadlil qabr laylat al badri ala sa'ir al kawakib. So for many years, I think 20 years or so, that jumla actually puzzled me. I couldn't understand that why did the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam make a comparison between the ulama and use the moon as an example and not the sun. You know, why would he choose the moon when he compared the virtue of the alim over that of the sun? But when you study the moon closely, and we're fortunate, you know, we stay on farmlands. So what I do when I want to de-stress, my sons will tell you, they bought me a telescope because I'm into astronomy. That's my part-time passion. So I have one lens which I look at the moon normally. And it's very, very fascinating. And then when you study the moon, you will come to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created that moon in different stages. Sometimes you will refer to the moon as a hilal, and sometimes you will refer to the moon as Laylatul Badr, when it is in its full splendor. وَعَكَذَا يَتَفَاوَتُ الْعُلَمَا فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْعُلُومِ. Likewise, the ulama, their knowledge, they differs. Their knowledge differs in rank and status. So sometimes you will be in that part of your life where you will be like hilal. Very, very small, you know. But then when you exert yourself and you continue studying, you will reach that status where you will become like what the Nabi alayhi salam said, Kalayla, Kalbadri, Kalayla through Badri, you know, when the moon is in its full splendor. That is the first thing. The second thing is that the moon is a natural satellite. It doesn't have light, it's completely dark. It actually borrows light from the sun. Al-Qamru yustafadu min dawi shams. It borrows light. Hakad al-alim yustafadu min nuri kalami rasulillahi sallam wa af'ali wa qwali. That is actually, we are all darkness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this specific. And then that darkness, you know why the moon, why the Nabi alayhi salam actually brought the example of the moon? The sun is there. It doesn't change its shape. It stays like that. The moon starts off as nothing, grows, hatta adakal urjunul qadim, until it becomes completely obsolete. There's nothing, you have to wait and see when it comes out again. The sun is there, takes its same course every day, but the moon differs. And that is ulama, they will differ, and their knowledge will differ, their character will differ, until they reach that status. But the darkness of the night, that is dhulmatul jahli. And that alim, when he comes out, wherever there is darkness, he is like that moon. So that is why the Nabi alayhi salam actually praised the ulama when he said that they are like that. That is two. Number three, an abid. The example of an abid is used in this particular hadith. An abid, he only benefits himself. Yanfa'u binafsihi. Lakin al-alim yufidu wa yastafidu wa yantafiu binasu. He benefits, people benefit from him. And if he deprives them in this world of whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him of benefits, of knowledge, that is one thing. But he has the ability to deprive them in the year after also. Why? Because in the unfortunate event, if he has to end up in the fire of Jahannam, you must remember an abid will only enter Jannah through his own actions. Al-alim yuqal lahu ishfa to shafa. So when the alim ends up in the opposite side, not only is he depriving the people of the haq in this world, he will deprive them of Jannah. Those dependents who are dependent upon him, they dependent on him in the next life also. So the role of the ulama is very, very important. That is one part. Number two, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns the ulama on a certain level as well. I don't want to speak much about that now. But we are in a situation, we are in a time period, Maulana has mentioned it yesterday also, you know, that where the people actually need guidance from the ulama. And we should stop feeling sorry for ourselves. The spirit, the fighting spirit, the academic fighting spirit of the ulama, that is gone. We feel that we are the only people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given such conditions. It is not like that. I want to tell you one particular story, and that's why I'm always vocal. And I speak out, I really don't care. Maulana knows me like that. Whether it's the government, whether it's who, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to ask me about the haq. Allah's not going to ask me, why did you keep silent? Or why were you silent? And who silenced you? That is not important. In the time of Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, you know the fitna. When he went back to Bukhara, so the Amir of that time, Khalid al-Duhali, he called Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, that come to me, right? Uridu an asma minka al-jami wa tarikh. I want to hear and listen to your two compilations, which means the actual Bukhari and the tarikh Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala wrote. But see the spirit of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. The government is calling him. That is the wali of Bukhara, Khalid al-Duhali. He's calling him, come, I want to come. You know what was the reply of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala? He says, inni la udhillu al-ilma. Wala ahmilu ala abwabi nas. I will never ever disgrace knowledge, and neither will I take it to the doors of people, meaning to governments, etc. Today we don't even have to do that. We offer ourselves as friends of the court. We offer ourselves as many other aspects. The government is not even interested, but we avail ourselves just to curry favor with the government. Is that right? Then Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala says, in kana laka haja fati ilayya ila dariya ila masjidi. If you have a need for this book, then come to my house, come to the masjid, I will teach you. Wa illa fa anta sultan. If not, you are a sultan, famna'ni. Then prevent me from speaking the truth and prevent me from teaching this book. لِيَكُونَ لِي عُذْرٌ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. So that I can have an excuse in the court of Allah, the day of Qiyamah, that you prevented me from teaching this book. Allah. Now what happened? So Khalid al-Duhali, he was defeated. He couldn't understand. This imam, bichara, he's got nothing, just a compilation or two. So he enlisted, respected ulama, the help of a person, Al-Harith bin Abil Warqa, one of the ulama, you get always get ulama usu also, you know. And ulama usu, I always say it's ulama that you can physically sue. We should sue them because they're ulama usu. But nevertheless, he enlisted the help of, see, the government now enlisting the help of religious leaders. That same scene is playing out here in South Africa. Some of our ulama secretive meetings behind the doors with ulama, with government officials. We only came to know because the Jewish Board of Deputies, they opened the can of beans. Otherwise, we would not have known. The same people we're condemning, they actually exposed the whole thing. But this is what governments do. They enlisted the help of who? Religious leaders, the ulama of that time, to fight Imam Bukhari, to prove him wrong. And because they couldn't do it, they expelled him from his hometown. We are not going through such difficulties today. We have the manabir, we have the platforms. We're imposing so much difficulty upon the people. Wallahi, it is unreal. We have lost our communities. But nevertheless, he calls and enlists the help of, see, he's enlisting the government, Molina, enlisting the help of ulama. Our ulama availed themselves without even being enlisted. I'm ready. I don't know what is the perks or what they will be getting at the end of the day, but everyone wants to forward his narrative. Nevertheless, Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, got expelled from his hometown. He leaves his hometown. And when he saw that this, I'm fighting a losing battle, he made dua against them. He made dua against Khalid, Al-Duhali, he made dua against Al-Harith, and all of them, whatever, he made dua against them and their children. Yes, Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, Ya Allah, this fitnan, whatever they're accusing me of, turn this against them. And hatta marat aqalla min shahrin, not even 1 month passed in whatever he made dua against him, that has befallen him. He went further down. Abdul Quddus, the person that was with him, he says, Sami'atu, Imam al Bukhari, dhata laylatin. I heard Imam Bukhari one night making dua. Faqala, Ya Allah, qad daqat bi al ardu faqbidni ilayka. See, I did what I could do, Ya Allah. I spoke the truth. I stood my ground. I never sold your deen in your religion. So my time is exhausted. Rather take me away from this world so that I can return to you. See, he stood his ground. And because of his ikhlas and his sincerity, the most taught book in the world today is what? Imam Bukhari, because of his ikhlas. The sharah of the book that they make, the most sharah of is what book? Is that book of Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala. We still echoing his name, we still speaking about him today. That is the legacy left behind. That fighting spirit is gone from the ummah and from the ulama specifically today. We are accepting everything that the government is saying. And the saddest part, those ulama who are fighting to have the deen as it ought to be. Remember what your president said, we must find innovative ways. There's nothing innovative. You want us to become bidatis. What do you want? What do you mean by innovative ways? How must we innovate in the deen of Allah? You want us to innovate things. So you want to substitute the deen of Islam in its pristine form for institutionalized religion. That is what they want. And sadly, some of our ulama, they're complying, they're imposing this on the people in the public as well. We have all the facilities, we have the legal facilities. We don't need to fight these people. We can fight them legally. We cannot accept just what they are saying. You are taking lessons from a politician. Politicians, they are writing the rules with no medical background. But you want to question the ulama when they tell you this vaccine is haram, this is not permissible. That is. So what's the difference? You're accepting these idiots, these people, politicians, who are speaking a lot of rubbish. Most probably they bought their certificates also from some place also. You know everything is in the open. But the ulama who has some medical background, who studied Tibu Nabawi, who knows how to deal with pandemics and plagues, those people, Maulana said, they are being looked down upon. Our asatida, our shuyukh who are fighting to have salah as normal as possible, to have the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are being looked upon. The ahlul haq, the people of truth, they are being looked down upon. And the people of bid'ah, of innovations, and all these other things, rubbish that we are imposing today, they are being hailed as heroes, as saviors of the people. Saviors of what? Saving them in this life, which they're eventually going to die, or saving them of the year after. What are we actually saving? Allah's proved that, I said it last week in a bayan, the first place in the country that closed the masajid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, had the most COVID fatalities is the Western Cape. You fight against Allah's system, He will disgrace you openly. You go against Allah's system, this is what will happen. So when will the ulama, when we are all colleagues, we are all classmates, we are all, when are we going to take charge? It is not going to decrease our sustenance. It is not going to bring this grace upon us. If we die, we die as shuhada. If we die, we die as ahlul haq. Allah will take our legacy beyond our grave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make people speak after us. And that is always the case. That's why we're speaking about the ahlul haq today. Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. And Adhuhali, we're speaking bad of him. Why? Because he fought against Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. He's being cursed. Now, that scene that played out in the life, there's thousands of examples. The time does not permit, Molina, but next time, inshallah, when we meet again, there's thousands of examples. We are not the only people, not the first people. The people is going to turn against us tomorrow because they're looking for true guidance. For 1 year, some people didn't go to the masajid for Jummah. Molina also mentioned it yesterday. Some salawatul khams is gone. You think you're going to win them back now because Ramadan, you send out a few fadail of Ramadan, that will have absolutely no impact on the people because we permitted them for silly-nilly reasons to stay home. You have a flu, you have symptoms. What symptoms of what? How do you know what symptoms the person has? You have got no medical background. The government told you these symptoms, that could be flu symptoms, that could be any other symptom. They are the biggest symptoms of fitna and fasad, the government. They want to impose this. They are imprisoning you and me. And they only want to see who complies. So until we become vocal, until we speak out the truth, until we fear no one besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will substitute us with other people. And that is my fear, brothers. We've lost our communities. I think the time is exhausted, Molana. Our brothers, they're hungry. Molana's in charge of all my travels in elections on that side, inshallah. So one day when we have chance again, we will elaborate. But I do not want to keep you people up from enjoying all the meals. He's hungry, we're hungry. All these people are hungry also, you know, so Mawlana Khalid, inshallah, will come in and give us a few words. Jazakumullah khair, jazakumullah. Jazakumullah ahsana, jazakumullah ahsana.